Welcome back, Voice of Disruption, Ken Rakowski. Bebop is still hanging out with us here in the studio. Now, I gotta let everyone know that you have acquaintances, then you have friends, then you have great friends, and then you have best friends.
And then I know you.
And there's only a handful of people I would give a kidney to. It wouldn't be mine, but I would give it to you. No, I mean, sir, you're one of my best friends.
Thanks.
And we've known each other since the mid-90s, and we both have gone through roller coaster rides. And I would say right now where you're at, you're so pivotal to this planet. This planet needs you because you are challenging the status quo of transportation. So explain to me first what's broken in the world when it comes to transportation.
I think we saw the transportation industry, it's broken because it wasn't really putting humans in the middle. We built our cities around cars right now. How stupid is this, you know? When you consider that the car itself came out from an accident, you know, nobody knows that we have the petrol car just because there was a big fire in the factory where they were designing the cars. There was an electric car, there was several prototypes, and the only one that survived the fire was that one that was outside. It was discarded.
I didn't know that.
It was the less efficient. I know. That's something that blows my mind, how humanity end up into this trap because of an accident. And sometimes history plays the fool with us, but that's a particular case.
But cities are built around that form of transportation.
Cities are built in like this, and the result is that we are basing our entire infrastructure on consumption. Because now we are trapped into this model and we're polluting everything. It's not sustainable.
Make sure people understand, when you say consumption, every form of transportation today requires energy.
Require energy, and it doesn't make money. So it's all subsidized by us, by the tax that we pay. So everything, undergrounds, LA, for every dollar that the county takes for the ticket, they have to put $2.5 on top of subsidies to just break even, you know?
That's just one city.
It's one city. Mm. Imagine, spend it, and it's not even the worst, because if you see Detroit or several other...
Go to Mumbai.
Yes.
Mumbai's horrible. Shanghai. Well, Beijing. So you saw this as an opportunity.
Yes.
But several years ago, Elon Musk from SpaceX and Tesla and all these great companies mentioned this concept that most people don't know is actually an old concept. He said the word Hyperloop.
Yeah.
Hyperloop actually goes back to maybe
1813.
What happened in 1813?
Webster, the one entrepreneur, tried to build a mechanical system that was reduced of air, mm-hmm. very similar to the Hyperloop. This concept was failing at the beginning, an entrepreneur called Eli Beach in 1889 built the first prototype of what will be called New York Subway. Between Warren and Broadway, that is the first Hyperloop of history. And it was working. It was half a kilometer of reduced frictionless train inside a big tube.
What happened?
Well, the entire industry, especially the rail industry, at that moment there was the beginning of the rail industry, thought this was a threat mm-hmm. to them, and they just shut it down. In 1909, very important, Robert Goddard, the father of the rocket science, patented a solution that was very similar to the Hyperloop. If you see the model, it's incredibly similar, not levitating, but the rest was there. But he published it in Popular Science, mm-hmm. and the entire scientific community went against him, telling humans cannot travel above 100 kilometers per hour.
This is important, because he thought, because of physics, humans could not actually live past that.
And the entire scientific community was agreed to go against that, you know, heresy. Mm-hmm. And what happened, he became... We have a rocket industry now, so maybe it's good, but we don't have the Hyperloop. And the reason why it was doable right now is that the the system that they tried to build during the years were not optimized and didn't solve the real problem, that is efficiency. Now we have the technology to actually do it.
And the technology that's available has never gone into a Hyperloop. So when Elon Musk mentioned it, he mentioned a vision.
Right.
He didn't give the formula.
No.
He said this should happen.
Yeah.
So when he mentioned it, a bunch of people went off and said, let's try to do something. Some failed.
The first one ever was my business partner, Dirk, that 2 weeks later that Elon published the white paper, thought it was a crazy idea. And actually, he did it at Metal.
He did it at a group that you and I are part of, right?
Right. So he started the concept by doing, he knew that we didn't have all the answers, so he just did a call to action. He said, whoever wants to join my team, and it was at the beginning at Metal, but then we expanded very quickly. And incredibly enough, for the first 2 months, scientists from all over the world joined the team.
This is something called crowdsourcing.
Crowdsourcing.
But this is crowdsourcing at a mass level.
Now, what I did by joining the team, almost a year after this started, I did what I do best. I think I created 70 companies, and I have the skills to actually imagine organization. Mm-hmm. And what I brought to the project is actually the vision on how to organize this at the planetary level and make it scale in order to actually create a model out of it that can be replicable in every country and actually create what we have right now. 920 people working from 42 countries.
That's amazing.
I know. They said we are the biggest startup in the planet. I don't like the definition. I think we are the biggest effort that humanity did to put together the best minds in the planet. And that's the first time that actually this happens at the planetary level.
How do you do this, Bebop, where everyone's from all over the place? How do you keep them under one concept?
So first, it's we created a model, and then we created a technological solution to allow this. Luckily enough, we are hyper-connected, and technologies allow us to actually solve the biggest issue that you have when you create an organization.
Collaboration.
Communication and collaboration.
Okay.
That was the biggest challenge. In reality, to understand how we modeled it is very simple. We create groups of 7 people plus or minus 2.
Okay.
These people defines a list of assumptions. Mm-hmm. From that assumption, they get assigned a task that they have to solve. And there's a sprint, 3-4 weeks of sprint to solve that task. If it's possible in that time frame, the task is in. If it's not possible, it becomes a different task, a task for a next group.
Another group gets it.
Yeah. So that simplifies a lot. Inside the team, there's 3 people. We call it hyper leader, hyper master, and contributors. That's it. There's no real hierarchy. Hyper leader says what, hyper master says how and when, and they sprint. At the end of the sprint, this generates a white paper that goes anonymously to a second team that is called validation. And these people, there's no religion. That's why I get it anonymously, because engineering sometimes becomes a religion. If you have rock stars like
That's
we
right.
have, who
they
is going to tell
they
Craig
want validation.
Gadget? Right.
Yeah.
But who's going to tell Craig Gadget that his design is not good?
You don't want to do that.
Right.
So anonymous is
so
the way
anonymous
it works.
Is the way to go.
So let me make sure everyone understands. This is Bebop, by the way, Bebop Cresta. Hyperloop now is what's this transformative transportation methodology that is able to take people. Now, I know you can say it, but I've seen some numbers where it says Mach 3, which is 3 times the speed of sound. Even the speed of sound, which is 700 miles an hour, 1,000 kilometers per hour, is it real? Can that really happen?
So, you know what people doesn't know about G-force and speed of sound, 2 times, 3 times, it's that first, G-force is not a speed and is not a force. It's a measure of acceleration.
No, that's Mach. G-force is the gravitational pull on the body.
Yes,
right.
But it's not measuring a force.
Oh,
it's measuring an acceleration.
Got it.
So the unit of measure that we use tells you what? How fast you go at a certain speed.
Right.
So when you're saying we're going at the speed of sound 2 times, 3 times, in reality, you have also to express how fast you go there. And the Hyperloop has the incredible characteristic that you can actually go gradually and accelerate and decelerate slow enough
so
that you can
really
keep the comfort of the passenger constant.
What's comfortable? Like, if I take off on a plane, what am I normally experiencing?
Well, there you are. Sometimes you feel 2G in horizontal and one. Sometimes when there's some turbulence, 1.5 of G of lateral. And that's where you get discomfort.
What are you trying to achieve?
Less than 1G, 0.8, and 0.5 of lateral G.
So taking off or accelerating?
It's boring. you don't feel it.
No. But and you're looking at tracks that probably will exist more outside the United States initially than
initially.
Inside the States.
Well, we also look in, we have now some very enthusiastic projects in US.
But what I'm saying is because of easement and land rights, it's probably easier for countries that govern the entire, like a Saudi Arabia or Indonesia. It's
Abu Dhabi, India, yes.
And they would benefit greatly by having this transportation. Because what I'm looking at, it's not just about transportation, it's also about power.
Yes.
You become almost a new power company too, don't you?
Exactly. So everybody is talking about speed. Everyone is in love with the speed of sound. In reality, that's not the most interesting part of the Hyperloop. Efficiency. The way we can move people spending a very tiny fraction of the energy that you use in any other system. Mm-hmm. That's the most exciting. Why? First, it costs almost nothing to move the people. We have
Los Angeles. It costs nothing. It actually costs nothing.
Right. Well, the cost itself, it's between Los Angeles and San Francisco, is $5 per passenger. But the reality, you can produce more energy than you consume by using a combination of renewable energy. And actually, you can, in the future, imagine a system that subsidizes itself by producing more energy. Because the efficiency of solar panel is going up and the price is going down. At a certain point, the energy that you produce will repay the entire infrastructure.
But if a country like India has been talking about doing this, if they implement a Hyperloop in India, how does that affect the population?
So it has a tremendous impact because India has 80% of the rolling stock and 70% of the transportation on the ground that is obsolete, you know, and some of the cars has passed their expiration by 30 years, 40 years. So they are danger machine, you know. This is really a dangerous situation that 1.3 billion people are facing every day.
And a Hyperloop, does it cost to create the infrastructure? Is it more than what a lot of these rail structures are?
So first, we are cheaper. We
are less expensive, by the way. Use proper words.
Less expensive. Thank you. I'm the only one speaking in English, by
the way. Kidding.
The entire planet doesn't know how to speak
English. Okay, it's cheaper. It's cheaper. By a factor of what?
By a factor, if you compare it to high-speed rail, 4 to 6 times less expensive than high-speed rail. Yeah. But the most interesting part is not how much does it cost, is how long does it take to recoup the entire investment. And this is incredible.
ROI.
Yes. Because now we're talking about in some countries like India, 2-3 years to recoup the entire investment.
Where if it's high speed rail, what's it take?
It takes never.
You're right.
So there's no way that a high speed rail recoups an investment anywhere in the planet. We analyzed all the projects. There's no, and that's not their model. Their model is subsidies.
So what will the planet look like in 20 years from now?
It will be a beautiful planet.
Will we have Hyperloops 20 years from now?
Oh yeah. We have more than one Hyperloop. Yeah. We have several Hyperloops around the world. The beauty of this system is they can scale up because we have new technology that can actually build 100 kilometers per year. So you don't see anymore 20 years of work to build an highway that when it's finished, it's already obsolete because it's already full of cars. So this was insane. But the beauty of it is that we will have a fully frictionless system that will allow you in 20 years to start from your own, take what we call agent, self-driving into an airlock, going inside the Hyperloop.
Just say point-to-point transportation.
point to point, but the Hyperloop will be only the superhighway of a more complex system of things that flies, that
self-drive. How do people find out more? What's the website?
www.hyperloop.global.
That's it. Bebop, appreciate you hanging out with us. It's changing the planet. Watch what he does. Bebop Cresta. He's doing some incredible stuff. Hyperloop. Got a lot more. Ken Rakowski. Bebop. Right here, Voice of Disruption. We'll be right back.